Welcome to Oregon Voters Digest, the program that brings forward the social and political issues that are important to people living here in the Pacific Northwest. And now, your host, Bruce Broussard.
Welcome again to this segment of the Oregon Voters Digest. I've got one of my associates here with me today, Theresa DuPay. And boy, I'll tell you, you know, imagine talking about issues within the Voters Digest. In fact, it's the oldest issue within the state of Oregon. It was the first blue book in the state of Oregon. And it's all about issues, like I said to you before. And we're talking about issues across the board, and not necessarily just Portland. We're talking about around the state and sometimes the country, but specifically Oregon. And one of the areas that that Oregon tends not to want to talk about is on the issue of race.
Yes.
Across the board.
Yes.
And today's IE definition of race tends to focus itself within the city of Portland, in the Portland metropolitan area. And that's just the way it is. And I'll just say, as part of the solution, just jumping one step ahead of this aspect of it, we're right in the midst of change.
Mm-hmm.
We've got the, as you know, to quote the brand, baby boomers.
Yeah.
Now those baby boomers, if you will, have retired. These dead mom and whatever. But now the baby boomers' kids.
The Gen Xers.
The Gen Xers, whatever they are, but they're 35, 40 years mm-hmm. old. And guess what? There are a lot of them are educated, mm-hmm. few jobs. So the competition for those jobs are keen.
Mm-hmm.
And so as a result of that, race tends to raise itself up, because the fact of the matter is everybody's vying for jobs. And guess what? Hey, if you're my friend and we went to school together, guess what? And that's been normal kind of a deal. Guess what? You get the job. If you, on the other hand, if you've got your resume and it's equal and whatever, and someone on this side of the deal happens to be this, that, and the other, you got long legs or short hair or whatever, that's reminded. It's competition, big
yeah.
time. It's taken a whole different light, if you will, at this point in time.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying this right at the beginning because, you know, Oregon has a kind of a reputation nationwide as being the whitest state in the union. Okay, obviously, we were just a nice little Pacific Northwest, and the grass were greens, and the city of Portland, the city of roses, and everything else. And all of a sudden, the stuff started getting brown and stuff like that. I.e., folks from the East Coast have been coming to this area.
Mm-hmm.
We just got out of a social arena, if you will, as far as affirmative action for everybody, for that matter. We just started spending money and giving houses away and giving this away, just free for all aspect of it. And right now, all of a sudden, the country is really taking a big hit of this piece. When you think about New York, I can still remember going back down for visitation or something like that, and you saw homeless folks on the streets and this, that, and that. People just walked by like there was nothing happening. But
yeah.
you got millions of folks that are living in that area. But in our area, that was not the case. Nobody wanted to come to Portland, Oregon.
Right, it was a small town.
It was a small town. You had Seattle on one side,
mm-hmm.
you had California on the other side. They just drive through.
Yeah.
In fact, they wouldn't even stop here and drop by and get in the weed.
Yeah.
But we wasn't even here. It was just in California. You'd go over there, of course, beer. Remember that?
Yeah, I remember.
But so the name of the game is that, but now we're, I just want to kind of say that we need to have the discussion, because, in fact, we are the melting pot of this world, for that matter. And so, obviously, we got over 100 cultures and whatever. So, I mean, that's race, too. I mean, everybody's kind of trying to get their own niche. But at the end of the day, it's all about eating. It's all about making a living, a roof over your head and food and this, that, and the other. So I just want to throw this out. To basically to kind of lead into what we're going to be talking today. He got Theresa right here with me, and we're going to be talking about an issue here in the city of Portland. And, you know, housing is big, it's huge, it whatever. And so we've got an issue here in the city of Portland because we just elected, if you will, another person. What, we elected two people?
I think so. Yeah.
It was two people. We had Eudaly,
mm-hmm.
a young lady who was kind of an activist in her own right aspect. She got to the business on rent control and whatever. But the whole idea, here is that, and Teresa's going to kind of get in a little bit more. Well, she'll translate some of the things that I just shared with her. Dawn and I always we like that piece aspect of it. So we're going to go on and talk about an issue as it relates to race here in the city of Portland, and it's right here. Okay, T.
Article.
Let's go. Let's talk about it.
An article that was published in.
Hit the headline first. Let's hit the headline first.
The Portland Tribune. Bureau chiefs ousted, diversity disappears. And this is an excellent article by Beth Slovic. She used to write for Willamette Week. And basically, Portland Commissioner Chloe Eudaly axed two longtime bureau directors just months into her first term. And I'm going to read a quote. Yeah. Their departures in March and April respectively leave 19 out of 21 city bureaus with leaders who are either white men or white women. The two additional bureaus, one small and the other obscure, are led by black men. So I think this is an important issue. This is an issue of race. This is an issue of accountability. This is an issue of truthfulness. Mm-hmm. If she's going to lead people to believe that she promotes diversity, racial diversity, and then she ousts these two people who are both people of color.
Well, black.
Everybody,
you know, all kinds of colors.
Right.
Let's make sure what we're talking about. Black is always the lead.
Her actions are speaking louder than her words. Right. And then here it says that her chief of staff, Marshall Runkel, declined to talk about specific personnel issues, but he acknowledged Portland's bureau directors do not reflect the city's diversity. He added that Eudaly wants to include more voices in city government that bring different ethnic and economic perspectives. So I'm presuming that means different racial backgrounds too. And I'm wondering how she's planning on accomplishing that when she decides to fire two men of color that have been there for
long. Two blacks.
The
blacks are the lead. I keep bringing up the black.
Two black men who were doing a great job.
Been there for years.
Right, for years. I believe Scarlett was hired by Randy Leonard in 2005. And there's another quote in here that's really important. Randy Leonard is quoted as saying that he's worried that the message being sent to the community when the city cuts in half its roster of black and Latino bureau directors is basically that. You know, what message are they sending to Portland when they get rid of these two successful black men who...
But then they were forced to hire these two black folks anyway, especially Scarlett, because the federal government came down during Randy Leonard's place and said, hey, finally, you know, you're just discriminating against people of color or blacks.
So,
he got hired.
That's a really good point. So what are we going to have to do now? Are we going to have to, you know, go and have another lawsuit just to make sure that there are more people of color included in City Hall? What message does this send? And this also goes back to what Fred Stewart has said about rent control. He wrote an excellent editorial called Rent Control is Racist Public Policy. It's on his website. And he talks about rent control and how intrinsically racist it is for a variety of reasons that he really understands well, because he's a real estate broker and he's got so much experience with that. It's going to push out more people, more black people out of Portland. It's going to bring in more white people and more wealthy white people.
Actually, a lot of people, basically of all races for that matter. But like you said, blacks, when you start thinking about gentrification, no one says anything about the whole issue of gentrification in Northeast Portland, the district primarily where not all blacks are living, but where a number of them were living aspect of it. But no one says anything about that.
And that whole area, Northeast, North Portland, that's just been transformed and it's very, very white now, and there's just been this influx of white people, and black people are moving farther south or farther east into Gresham. And I was talking to Fred a few weeks ago, and he was saying how that's just going to continue. Rent control will make that happen. And he says part of the reason is because a lot of rent controlled buildings are managed and operated by white people, and they historically have a habit of having their friends and their family, hey, I'll get you set up. You know, I'll get you this great two-bedroom apartment. Come on in. And then you have a building that's supposed to, you know, be an example of some kind of social equity, and it's all, you know, all the tenants are white.
But then when you start thinking about rent control, you think about landlords and things. Yeah. Probably one of the largest landlords in the city of Portland happened to be sitting on city council. Dan Salzman.
Right.
Dan Salzman. Right. You know, he's a millionaire type kind of a guy. Right. It was quoted in the Oregonian on several different occasions, aspect of it. You would think with that kind of a background, we wouldn't have gotten to this particular point.
Yeah.
That the issue of rent control, the rent of housing, and this, that, and the other, we should have been right off the bat. Mm-hmm. Every community would have been very positive. No high rise, making sure the consideration would be taken care of. Parking off the street, no parking off the street. People are worried across the board. This is not going to be our old Portland city of roses anymore. Right. It's going to be high rise all the way from the river, probably all the way up to I don't know, basically 39th or something
you know,
like that?
That's true. And I remember when I was listening to Stuart Emmons at that panel at PSU year or two ago, and he was talking about how he was really concerned that Portland was going to end up to become another L.A. or another San Francisco.
Oh,
and
New York.
I see it happening.
It's going to be that way.
Yeah.
That's where we are. But my point is that we had people sitting on the city council. Mm-hmm. Who had been there for years.
Yeah.
Solomon has been the housing czar for years. And here we are today. And by the way, he's going to be up for re-election. It'll be interesting. We're going to try to see if we can bring it up on the table.
And I want to mention also, I want to say this. You know, I'm not really a big fan of Chloe Eudaly. I know a little bit about her past. You know, I've heard from people in Portland. This situation with Scarlett and you know, this really proves that she's really not interested in racial diversity. If she had been, she would not have allowed this to happen. And I wonder who encouraged her to do this.
I got an idea.
Because the fact is, Chloe Eudaly has had, I think, one or two jobs in her life. She has absolutely no political experience, and she doesn't even realize how naive politically she is, how she could be manipulated by someone infinitely more experienced, infinitely better educated, someone with a lot of experience in city government.
But then think about it, though. You got, like you said, they were activists. Mm-hmm. She was part of the activist group. That was her platform when she ran for office.
Right.
Okay, and when she ran for office, I mean, people were more interested in, hey, we got to do something about these potholes and things of that nature. It was a timing kind of a deal.
And I think also her activism also for homeless issues and for housing.
Yeah.
That's great, but she's not.
But my point is that had she stayed with the platform, she could have OJT'd the politics.
Yeah.
You got me?
Yeah.
She did all the job. See, if she just stayed to that part aspect of it, but unfortunately, she changed. She stayed there. And so now I'm looking at how did she get that to that position where she now was in charge of two bureaus, major bureaus.
Yeah.
And guess who assigned those bureaus to her in the interim basis? We got some dates here.
Okay.
We got some dates here.
You've done better research than me.
Yeah, we're talking about Mayor Ted Wheeler, our newly mayor.
Because seems to me like that Chloe Eudaly didn't just decide to get rid of these guys. She had to have gotten permission from someone higher up.
In fact, let's read a couple of these things here. It says the most recent change comes as Mayor Ted Wheeler is preparing to talk control of all city bureaus on April 27th, okay? The day he will release his proposed budget for the next fiscal year.
Mm-hmm.
He will reassign them after the budget is approved and will give them back to their previous commissioners if he is satisfied with their management of them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, there are some dates here, right?
Okay.
Chloe got that.
Chloe.
Who had those bureaus initially? Our dear friend Dan Salzman.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Right?
You
got
mentioned that, yeah.
And you got to remember now, they don't want anything like this on the pew, but yeah, let's get rid of these blacks, if you will. And Fish doesn't want it because he's going to be running again. Salzman wants to maybe run. He may not run. I think he's a little embarrassed now that the fact that he's making all this money, he's been making all this money sitting on that seat, right, as a landlord. So consequently, give it to Chloe. She doesn't know anything.
Right.
Boy, you know, she's naive. She didn't know what's going on.
She's extremely politically naive.
But give it to Chloe, and then all of a sudden, when the budget is approved, got me? Then the mayor, by the way, can control all the bureaus. He can just he doesn't have to give bureaus out to anybody.
Right.
So on the 28th, once the budget is passed, he'll just go back and say, Chloe, okay, well, fine. We'll take this out. We got to give it to someone a little bit more responsible than you.
Right.
Maybe Nick Fish. Mm-hmm. Or maybe Dan Salzman.
That will be interesting. It'll be interesting to see what happens. Yeah. So in the interim, he's basically I suspect he encouraged her to do this, and now she has to take the fall for it.
And then he didn't have to do that.
Right.
He could have kept it himself, but he didn't keep it. Right.
Yeah.
He gave it to Chloe, the person on the low. And that the same thing with reference to the other person, the other black that got fired, that was from Amanda Fritz's piece.
Right.
He took that from Amanda, okay? So Amanda looks clean now, see? So get rid of them both at the same time.
Yeah.
They're the two top people, black.
And you know, it's just so typical because it's what Portland City Council does. You know, Portland City Council members, you know, they talk a fine line about how we don't have enough racial diversity, and then what do they do? They do this. So their actions really speak louder than their words.
Right. Yeah. But then you got the other side of the coin. What about the black leaders of Portland? Where are they on this issue? In all due respect, where's the ministry? You know, where's the scan of newspaper? Where's it? In fact, I've got two copies here. The Portland Observer did put a piece out on the 12th mm-hmm. of April. Okay.
Yeah. City Hall shakeup.
City Hall shakeup. Mm-hmm. Second bureau director dismissed. And mm-hmm. they've got the two pictures.
Right.
They got Paul and they got Eudaly on mm-hmm. the piece aspect. Mm-hmm. But a very short article.
Right.
And when you compare that with the Tribune,
right,
they did an extensive job and educated people.
Right.
See, so consequently, you wouldn't know what had happened.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we're doing this show today. Very, very important.
Yeah.
So in essence, it's kind of like saying in so many words, they can't, in all due respect, they can't get the ads here in the paper. If you don't get the ads, you can't hire any staff.
Right.
So you can't get these folks out there working on them.
Mm-hmm.
So consequently, they got to do the best they can,
mm-hmm.
right? But
yeah.
the bottom line is that they can't do anything. And then on the scanner side of the deal, they did nothing. They did this. This should have been on the front page
right.
of the Scanner newspaper and also on the front page of the Observer.
Right.
But my point is that they've got issues, too, that they have.
Right.
I mean, they don't get the ads,
right.
so they don't get the money in some cases.
Yeah.
But that's allowed.
Well,
so that's another problem.
Beth Slovic wrote a really excellent article right here.
Where's some of the other points in there? There were some other points. Let's talk about that.
Well, Just the hypocrisy of her chief of staff saying that she wants to include more voices in city government that bring different ethnic and economic perspectives, and then she ousts two black men that have held the positions that they held successfully for so long. Somebody said I heard someone saying something along the lines that she didn't feel they were doing a good enough job or something. This is a woman that's never been...
Well, she's in the position to even make that statement.
Exactly.
You understand.
You know,
and then the idea is
she's uneducated. She didn't even finish her associate's degree. She's got basically a year of college, and she's a high school dropout with absolutely no political experience. And she's going to say that these college-educated men who had been in their positions for 10, 12, 14 years are somehow inadequate, and she has no experience to come to that conclusion.
Now, imagine now, you got the mayor-elect, Ted mm-hmm. Wheeler, sitting down talking to this young lady about mm-hmm. taking these two bills.
Right.
Taking this bill.
And she fell for it hook, line, and sinker.
No, but bottom line is that he's the articulate one.
Right.
Right?
Right.
He should not have done that.
Right.
So I blame him.
Okay.
I blame him
right.
for that piece. You got my point?
I see what you mean.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes.
She's new.
Right.
I mean, you got these experienced folks that
right.
are sitting up there.
They're playing
hey,
her
they're
like
playing
a violin.
Her. But guess what? We're here to help her because mm-hmm. in all due respect, I voted for the woman, too. At
I didn't
the same
vote.
Time.
Well, we can't vote
well,
for that
I did. No, I did because of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was running for mayor,
mm-hmm.
and the issues that she was talking about was part of my platform.
Right, right.
But I've been around for a couple mm-hmm. of days, aspect
right.
of it. But no, I don't blame her.
Okay.
I blame the system. Because Ted has already been in the system.
Well, exactly. And clearly, this is not a decision that she came to on her own.
No.
This
she
is
didn't.
Something that she had input with, definitely from Ted Wheeler. This is not something that
Ted basically, read my lips.
Mm-hmm.
You get no bureaus if you don't do this.
Right, right.
We'll give you something a little easier.
Yeah.
Because you got to remember, housing is at the front of the line.
Right.
So what happens if Dan leaves? Okay, who's going to pick up the housing bureau?
Right.
Maybe Nick? That's what I'm saying. Nick's going to need it for his plan. He's promoting himself now on Facebook
mm-hmm,
about
mm-hmm.
what he does every week.
Right.
He talks about all the things that he's, all the good things, kissing the babies on Fridays and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? He doesn't talk anything about those murals on MLK
right.
that he sits on, that he has the Arts Commission.
It's really discouraging. It's discouraging because it seems like racially we're going back in time, like 35 or 40 years. It's very discouraging. You know, those murals are important.
Yeah, it's
and
very
when
important.
Were they painted? They were painted in the
85.
Right.
85.
And there were several
by a black
others,
artist. By
right.
a black artist.
Right.
Okay.
And they're not valued. And it's really discouraging.
Oh, yeah.
It's just discouraging to see this happening in Portland. And also to know that so many black people in Portland just don't want to say anything because we don't have very many black people.
Well, now all due respect, the white folks are getting hit too. When you look at the population of the homeless right now,
yes.
they look more white to
exactly.
me.
Exactly.
I mean,
noticed that.
I have to search to find out the
right.
blacks. They've been gentrified, if you will, out mm-hmm. the area to begin with.
Yeah.
And then a lot of the folks who are here now that are homeless are from out of state.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, in the other part of the country, they're giving them bus fare to come to Portland,
right.
Oregon.
Come to Portland.
It was almost like the Rajneesh. Remember the Rajneesh?
Yes, I do.
I mean, I remember talking to some of the homeless folks over there saying, man, this is the best thing since sliced bread.
I remember when the Rajneesh was on, it was on the news every day for what, five straight
yes,
years?
Yes.
Every single day. It
yes.
was all about the Rajneesh
yes,
situation
Bruce,
over
and
an
some
antelope.
Some of the guys I interviewed were saying, gee, Bruce, I mean, hey, man, I mean, I can get my weed. They take mm-hmm. me down to, I mean, everything is nice. nice and clean. I'm fed. I get housed, the whole nine yards. Yeah. So we're kind of like falling right back in that same kind of a mindset, but here in the city of Portland. I mean, we were talking about roses. We were, I mean, the place was clean and everything was pretty nice. Like my wife Norma said that, she said, gee, well, look at it. You drive by Alberta, Alberta over here, Alberta Park and whatever, and you've got these guys that are sitting over there in an area, with grassy area there, and where women used to come in the morning and with their dogs and whatever and animals.
They're
and,
you know, just overtaken by homeless camps.
Oh, the homeless are there. Yeah. Some guy was, excuse me, was crapping over there under a tree. Some guy was pissing right in the open front.
Right.
And so they don't go over there anymore.
Right.
That's a sad situation. That's sick.
It is.
And then yet and still we got Wapato over there.
And, you know, I want to also mention, when I interviewed a couple weeks ago when we had Jesse Sponberg on, he made a really good point.
Yeah,
he made a really good point about the millions and millions of dollars on almost close to a billion or something that they've spent doing things like changing the tree codes. And so they're not really doing anything. They're not creating more shelters. They're not creating more housing. They're just spending that because I don't know if they even, I mean, do they really want to help Portlanders have housing, have access to housing? I mean, what are they really doing? You know, if they're wasting money on things like changing the tree codes, just like Jesse said.
Well, it's kind of, you know, I put it, we're transitioning. When, a lot of times when you're transitioning, it's kind of like, you know, it's all about self. You know, hey, you better get what you can because the world's going to come to the end. You know, all of a sudden, so everybody's grabbing. You can't take the money with you.
Exactly.
I mean, and a good example of that is in all due respect, when you think about the president-elect Donald Trump. I mean, why would a billionaire, any billionaire, anybody with money, want to run for office?
Right.
When you think about it, you know, when you look at his definition, I looked at him and from the standpoint, this guy was sitting down there in New York in high tower routine. He can go around the corner and have him a hamburger with no problem. Shoot the breeze with the people on the corner. He can call anybody in and whatever. But the other billionaires are kind of like, well, gee whiz, we've been controlling this thing for a long time. I mean, you can't run for office unless you have any money to get the flyers out.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe 1% or 10% of the people know what the heck's going on, right? So you get the flyer, make yourself look good, et cetera. So I think what had happened is that the billionaires sort of got together and said, hey, buddy, I can't travel anymore. My wife gets kidnapped, this, that, and the other. So what I'm going to do, why don't we get a meeting, have a meeting? I'm just giving you my opinion. Have a meeting around the table and say, we need some help. We need to get somebody that knows how to go out there and talk to these folks. The only place in this country, in our country, in America, is New York.
Yeah.
I mean, the sanctuary cities have taken over California, so it's New York now, see?
Yeah.
And, you know, you go to New York, that is kind of little America. And so Trump fit the, he's got money, but he can communicate. And anybody, everybody, for that matter. So they picked him up. And so they all of a sudden.
I also wonder why did he run?
Yeah, but my point is that's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
I am saying he had to run.
Yeah.
He said, okay, fine. You know, I'll do one term or maybe do two terms. But in all due respect, when you think from a political standpoint, it was all about the Supreme Court. They might have had their ideas about the Supreme Court getting the seats in control. But in all due respect, things have changed. Things have changed. You know, it's not about Republicans and Democrats anymore. It's that new era now, the new baby boomer kids. That are saying, no, it's about the country here now.
Yeah.
I've got my kids. I want them to go to school.
Yeah.
I want to eat, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Well, yeah, and I think also people are just tired of the economic disparity.
Yeah,
they're tired of the haves and the have-nots.
That's right.
You know, and the dwindling middle class.
Yes,
and,
yes.
You know.
Then you got the Congress. They want to wipe those folks out.
Yeah.
I mean, they want to get rid of all of them because all of them are millionaires, you know what I mean? Because you get your portfolio when you walk in. After the first time, let's say you're representative, House of Representative, we got some local yokels ourselves, you know. We got the Earl, you know, Earl the Pearl, and he didn't play basketball, but anyway, we got Earl the Pearl, we got, and you got the others. I don't even remember their names to a certain degree, and now all of a sudden they're being pushed. He and let's see, who's the other person that's pushing this Central City Concern piece? That's right. I did have it. What's the woman that the other? She's a congressperson. Dementi and Donna something. Anyway, Donna something. Suzanne something.
Suzanne. Okay.
Yeah, she was on your vote, my vote, or whatever today aspect of it. And again, they was talking about not that particular case, but I saw an article where we were talking about sanctuary city.
Yeah.
They want to make the whole state sanctuary city.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute. give me a break. What about all these homeless folks? What about all these Americans, these Oregonians, if you will, that are out of work and this, that, and the other? And these other folks are getting free education, and free food, everything.
The other thing is that ICE is still coming in and taking people, you know? So they talk about the sanctuary city, which I definitely agree with, but I mean, what does that even mean when they're allowing people to be taken? You know, and in some cases, there was the man that was, I mean, he came here when he was 3. He doesn't, you know, he speaks Spanish, but, you know, I mean, he's an American. He was raised here since he was 3, and they were going to try to deport him. And I think he, you know, finally prevailed. But, I mean,
in all due respect, you know, we may have a little agreement, but I'll tell you what, as a solution to that whole issue for Sanctuary City and this, that, and the other, and wanting to care about these kinds of folks and whatever, whomever for that matter, tell you what, why don't each one, why don't people just raise their hand and say, I'll take one home with me.
Nobody's going to do that.
Wait a minute. But why you want to do it on my time?
Yeah.
I can't afford my own situation.
Well,
I'm
exactly.
Trying to take care of my own
and
family.
Portland needs to take care of the homeless that we have.
Yeah.
You know, Portland needs to take care of the homeless and the low income that are trying, the low income families that are homeless that need housing. You know, we need to do that first.
And then folks from back east, in all due respect, we had all kinds of programs here to get in housing.
Mm-hmm.
You got me?
Yeah.
They were sharp. They were educated. They came to Oregon. They came to Portland.
Mm-hmm.
They filled out the form. They were unemployed. Hey, you can get a free house. All you have to do is just sign here. And
things were good in the 70s, the 80s, and the 90s, see? But it's getting really competitive now.
It's very competitive.
Really,
and, you know, so basically, viewers, and for the benefit of the viewers, you know, we're just sharing various opinions and our observations based on our affiliations, right, and association, because we're all creatures of our exposure, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
See, so now what do
but
we do?
It's just very disappointing, and I just want to reiterate that this article, "Bureau Chiefs Ousted, Diversity Disappears," by Beth Slovic, is an excellent article that all Portlanders should read. And it details how Chloe Eudaly fired.
And that's the latest. That's the latest issue of the Portland Tribune, by the way. Now, fortunately, we have the Portland Tribune that's here, because in all due respect, it's free. Mm-hmm. It's sitting right there in the corner. Like I said, you can get this article right now. All you do is just go down one of the corners.
It's a great newspaper.
It's a great newspaper.
Yeah.
In fact, it is the newspaper,
yes,
if you will.
It is.
You know, right now, because because you got some very interesting folks. You got Redden, you got Jim Redden, you got Nick Bunick, and you got Slovic, and these folks all came from Willamette Week.
Well, you know, I remember when the Portland Tribune first came out years and years ago, and the Oregonian and other people joked about how it wouldn't last 2 years, and it's still here, and it's a wonderful newspaper, and it's,
by the way, the owner, Dr. Pamplin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
A Republican.
Yeah.
he owns the paper, and he's allowing this to come in.
Yeah.
The man is a very fair man, a very honest man, aspect of it. But had it not been for the Portland Tribune newspaper, we couldn't be talking about this issue.
Right.
We don't have the dollars, if you will, to go out there and do all this research, but it's wrong. And in all due respect, Wheeler is, in fact, OJT in the job.
Mm-hmm.
But this gives him an opportunity to basically share with him how he can fix things and get back on target.
Well, it doesn't look good for him, because the reality is Chloe Eudaly would not have done this if she hadn't gotten the okay from him.
That's right.
He's the big boss.
And he's the sharpest guy running around.
He's very sharp.
He's sharp in his own way.
Mm-hmm.
But he won't come over here and interview with Don and I. I don't know why. I mean, Don is a very low-key guy.
But you got that interview with him that you did years ago, right?
Well, we're gonna put that out there. You know what I mean? But right now, I'm trying to help him out.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we're mentioning his name.
Yeah.
You see, all he has to do is all he needs to do now is tell the public, hey, look here, I got her for this.
Mm-hmm.
And but at the end of the day, we're gonna be watching to find out who's gonna get that bureau.
Right.
Who's gonna get that bureau after the budget is passed?
That will be very interesting to find out.
Nick Fish gets it, right?
Yeah.
He gets it. Oh, look here, vote for me. I'm the bureau chief right now.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Dan is, hey, look, don't say anything about me, so give it to Nick. So this way Dan can get out.
Mm-hmm.
He can go on and spend his millions.
It'll be interesting
to see. Isn't it going to be interesting?
Yeah.
Then the key is that who's going to run?
Mm-hmm.
Who's going to run for office?
Mm-hmm.
I see a lot of folks lining up, if you will, to want to run for office. And that's going to be another interesting. Be seeing what the crop is going to be.
Yeah,
that's
Fred,
what we're going to
Fred
be.
Says he might run again.
He might run. Fred might run.
Fred Stewart.
Then, I don't know, you know, Don might run again, you know, then Bruce might run again. You know, we just kind of, but my point is that, you know, if you don't have the money,
Yeah.
You know, but we do have a system such if you pay the filing fee mm-hmm. for that short period of time, mm-hmm. you can put the platform on the table.
Yeah.
And that's fair, okay? But we do have the
Oregon Voters Digest. It does take money, and I heard that Chloe Eudaly had a lot of financial support from people in the community because they liked her platform, which was focusing on housing, equitable housing,
yeah.
rent control.
Yeah. Hey. She was good. She was good
so
at the time.
She got
and
it.
She represented a base.
Yeah.
She should have stayed with that base. But yeah. my point is that, you know, when you get in that kind of an arena, if you
well, she's a perfect example of a politician or a wannabe politician making a lot of promises before they're elected, and then when they're elected, they start breaking them and they start doing things that are, you know,
yeah.
a little sketchy.
But she had the base. All she had to do is had she stayed with the base,
mm-hmm.
but that money pushes
yeah.
you.
Yeah. Yeah.
You had the
exactly.
power. Okay. Yeah. That was another little piece, but maybe we might mention on the front, and we're going to take a short break. And then we're going to come right back, but there's another little piece talking to housing.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that. Okay, we'll take a short break, folks. We'll be right back. Go warm up your coffee and come right on back. Thank you.
You are watching Oregon Voters Digest. This program can be seen again on these channels on these dates and times. Tell a friend.
Are we okay? Okay, hey, we're back. Again, this is Bruce Broussard. I'm a co-host now. We're Don with the Oregon Voters Digest. And Don is my sidekick from the standpoint besides police. He also is a veteran.
I am.
And we've been basically reaching out to veterans and making sure that they get out there and get their benefits and the like and whatever. It's very, very important. And I'm here to say that a number of the veterans are off the street. A number of the veterans, but there still are some veterans that are out there. The VA is trying to do everything they can. They still have problems with mental illness, folks like that,
yeah.
because they get them in the housing, and guess what? They can't meet the criteria, and then they put them back out on the streets again. So that's another issue there, because the VA is saying, hey, boom, and you know, when you get on a base, you got to be pretty straight, or any military base, for that matter. But again, like I said, don't forget your benefits. We got the federal benefits here for veterans, dependents, and survivors. This is quite a little Bible here aspect of it. For families or relatives or anything of that nature, get a copy of that. Just call up the VA. You for the VA benefits, just give them a call at 1-800-827-1000. 1-800-827-1000. And they can talk to you about all the benefits for veterans. So if you got relatives that are veterans and they're sitting there, whether it be in a home or whatever here or that, and you know they were in World War II or Korean War or Vietnam War or whatever. You can call the VFW, the Veteran of Foreign Wars and whatever. And by the way, and you can go get your benefits. In fact, the VFW has the contract to fill out the paperwork. Very interesting. Just go out to the VA. So, yeah, please, don't forget that piece aspect of it. So, Don, you want to say anything else about the vet
well,
thing? How you doing in the vet deal? Anything else?
I worked with the homeless population for mm-hmm. several years.
Did you?
Yes, I did. A lot of them, of course, are veterans. And they fail for the same reasons that any other homeless people fail, they get housing,
mm-hmm.
they get set up, and then they go back to their addiction,
yeah.
their alcohol,
mm-hmm.
and so they fail again. So it's a continual problem, whether you're a veteran or whether you're not. when you get your housing, you gotta obey the rules.
Yeah.
You
know. Yep.
So.
Yep. So that's the
answer. You can't show up drunk. You can't show up high. Yep. You can't. And it's a continuing problem with homeless people generally.
Right. But at the same time, though, the VA should at least take care of that too.
Absolutely.
They need to go to the next law, not throw these people out.
Right.
Actually, if they're in the mental illness aspect of it, whatever, or whatever it is, take care of it.
Yep.
Take care of that issue at
absolutely. Point. I agree the veterans should be taken care of.
Exactly.
I'm a veteran, and they don't need to take care
and
of
I know you will then make sure they do that too.
Right.
By the way, I might add that remember one of the concerns that we had was these guys with the plats out there on the corners and whatever, but weren't veterans, but they were using it.
Yeah.
Guess what? I don't see that much of it.
I don't
see that, because every time I see one, I get out, talk to the guy.
Yeah.
I might give him a buck or two, but I say, man, you can't catch you on the corner here no more.
Yeah.
Now, if you got a problem with housing or mental illness or whatever, go down to the county.
Yeah.
Go to the county on Thursday morning about 9:30, because that's when the full council meet.
Yeah.
And just walk in there with your bag and everything else and says, I'm looking for a home.
Yeah.
Or if not that, I got mental illness aspect of it, because that's the bureau that basically is supposed to take care of the mental issues within our city. Fair? Got me? So I want to make sure that folks know that that's why you don't see that many, because Dawn and I out there we're looking for those kinds of folks and trying to see if we can do something. By the way, when we had that first half hour aspect of it, that was one other area that I wanted to make sure we brought up to the table in regards to housing in the city of Portland, because that's basically where he's handling most of this stuff. There was an article in the 18th, the Tuesday 18th of the Tribune, and by the way, if you pick up that copy, it's in the business section of the paper. And but anyway, there was an article about council kicks Ankeny, A-N-K-E-N-E-Y, apartments back to developer, PDC, Portland Development Commission. The bottom, and PDC, that's in the city of Portland.
Yes.
But a gentleman by the name of Crowell, and I knew him because he happens to be a black, an African-American, Crowell. He's trying to build in Southeast Portland, trying to build an apartment complex there. And he's having all kinds of problems. They've said no to him on and on and on. And it's just a very interesting piece. But anyway, Portland's past and future collided at the city council last Wednesday. At issue was the proposed construction of new six-story apartment building in a part of town where the council has encouraged growth in Southeast Portland. The Ankeny Apartments at 1122 Southeast Ankeny Street would be seventh net zero multifamily project in the country. The building would also partly wrap around two historic Victorian homes on the same block. The homeowners are opposing the project, saying it would dwarf their properties and harm their lifestyle. Here's a guy trying to build housing with a low income. He happens to be black in Southeast Portland, and you think that's what they would, but he doesn't get the support, right? You got me? So that's a good one. You got to watch on this one. We're going to watch this also. PDC, Portland Development Commission, i.e. Ted Wheeler, right? Because he's responsible at the end of it. What are you going to do about Mr. Crowell? He's an African-American. By the way, he's using his own money. He owns the property. This is not a social welfare deal. He's just providing houses like the rest of the folks. And he's getting all kinds of ramifications of saying no, 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 no. Okay? Well, now that we've done that piece, let's talk a little bit about the whole issue of police again. I mean, where are we today on that piece? Where is that? Where are we? Where are we? Where are we? Where are we?
Portland Police Department is pretty
and sheriff. That's
pretty messed up right now.
Okay.
So many of the leaders are under suspension for lying or cheating or being drunk or not following the rules. Marshman, the chief, has just been reinstated.
Just reinstated. I thought it was interesting.
Just been reinstated, and I'm not sure why.
Is he going to get appointed, you think, for chief?
I don't understand how you can lie on official paperwork and continue with your job.
But Ted said he didn't.
Yeah, well, he did.
But you understand what I'm saying? But
somebody,
the mayor said, hey,
somebody lied.
But why did Ted say, okay, because he rehired him, right? You got me?
You put him back at least for a while. I don't know how it's going to work out. I don't like it.
Okay.
I don't like the way it's coming about. There's too many of these upper management people who are not obeying the basic rules of the job. You know, you can't lie, you can't cheat, you can't be drunk. We got 10 of them that are under investigation. I don't know how Mr. Wheeler can solve that problem. I know how I'd solve it, but I don't know how he's going to solve it.
Same thing. You and I would solve it easy.
Yeah, you know.
If you either, you're either the mayor of the city or you're not, right?
Yeah.
Is that fair? You got me? But my point is, I'm sort of like trying to give him credit from the standpoint. Evidently, he must have known something that we, the public, don't know.
Yeah.
He hired him back because he figured, well, the guy, the paper kind of laid it out from the standpoint of saying, no, he did not.
He probably didn't think that he would prevail in the long run with arbitration, and he may be right. And that's one of the problems with the police is they always arbitrate someone who's done something wrong back into a job they shouldn't have.
But what about the morale of the citizens as well as the police department?
They're not really not concerned with the morale of the citizens.
Huh?
They're not? I don't think they're not considering the morale of the citizens. How can you let the police department degenerate to this kind of a situation and not be ashamed of your leadership?
Hmm.
You know, well, it's the same old. It's.
But then we got Daryl Turner, who happens to be the president of the union aspect of it, and that's a tough job. I mean, that's a tough job from the standpoint. He's supposed to be basically overseeing, just like a good first sergeant, making sure that they're carrying out the policies, if you will, the guidelines, if you will, right, of law enforcement. Fair? Got me? But in many ways, though, the perception of most police departments are in the cities and whatever is if they're running the city. That perception is still heavy in there. How do we get out of that, Don? Any thought?
Well, you're right. They are. They do run the city, and.
But do they really want to run the city?
Yeah,
they really do.
I'm sure they do.
But for what reason? I mean,
power is the aphrodisiac.
What?
Power is the ultimate aphrodisiac. Yeah. Somebody said. I think his name was Kissinger. So
how do we get out of that?
Well.
We got a new crop.
You really
of
want to know?
Please tell us what we need. We need to know the solution. What do we need to do? They can be law enforcement officers, not police. Law enforcement officers. Because in all due respect, the laws are supposed to be generated by us, and then we got elected officials that organize this stuff. At the end of the day, we sign off, and then at the end of the day, they're given the orders and said, okay, fine. These are the laws that you enact. Fair? Isn't that the way it's supposed to be?
Yeah.
So now what happened?
People keep asking, what's wrong with the police department?
Mm-hmm.
And what's wrong with the police department is they don't have the same accountability if they break a law or if they lie that you and I do. They have a whole separate justice system just for the police. It's precinct level in that it's called internal affairs. It has a captain, it has investigators, it has a budget, it has office space, it has secretaries that type up all that stuff.
All right.
So we have a precinct level, precinct expensive bureau that does nothing but whitewash what the police do. That's the problem. How do we get rid of it? Simple. Simple and very complicated. You and I were talking a little bit earlier. On two separate occasions, the Supreme Court has said that separate is not equal. They said it in transportation and federal transportation. You can't have buses for white people and buses for black people. They said that separate is not equal. Then in Topeka, Kansas, many years ago, somebody named Brown sued the Board of Education.
Right.
Because they weren't getting equal opportunity to schools.
Right.
This little girl wanted to go to a school close by. They said, no, you have to go to this black school way, way over here. And she says, no, I'm not going. And that's what the Board of Education was about. And the Board of Education said, the Supreme Court said, that you separate is not equal. Now, and they brought the 14th Amendment into this again. The 14th Amendment says, equal opportunity for all. Okay. Now they've said it's not equal in transportation. It's not equal in education. So why is it equal in law enforcement? That's it. That's the
why
thing.
It's
not equal in
it's
law enforcement.
It's not equal.
If they have a separate judicial system, which they do, it's unconstitutional. Some lawyer, somebody needs to take this to the courts. And eventually, I feel that the Supreme Court would say, as they have said in the past, that separate is not equal. You can't have a separate judicial system for the police. They have to have the same judicial system we do. That's the only solution to taking care of what we call the police problem. They're not accountable. They shoot too many people. They lie. They cheat. There's only one way to stop that, and you have to make them go before the same judge that I go to if I get arrested for drunk driving or disorderly conduct. It has to be the same for all. Equal opportunity. Equal. 14th Amendment. It's so simple, I don't understand why people don't understand it, and it makes me scream. Now, there's a simple solution.
There's
two solutions, and I've talked about this before. Number one, the chief of police or the mayor simply transfers everybody out of internal affairs. In other words, internal affairs doesn't exist anymore. Well, what are you going to do with these cops? You've got to put them on the street. You're going to put them back doing police work, going back to writing traffic tickets, investigating accidents, taking calls on burglars, prowlers, and murders. That's what policemen do. The second thing that you should do, I would do, is I would have someone approach the federal government. Now, we need to have a federal injunction that says, no, the Portland Police Department will not violate the 14th Amendment anymore, ever again. It also strikes me as unconstitutional and illegal to have anything in your contract as a policeman that says you can do these things. How can you have violation of the Constitution in your contract that says you don't have to, you don't have to appear before the same boards as the rest of us do? How can that be? It can't be. The solution is as simple and straightforward as getting rid of it.
Well, now, when we reference the system that responded, you said the federal government, right? That means that we have to go up down to Washington, D.C. or whatever. But within our own state, we've got representatives. We got Earl Blumenauer.
We need somebody that will take one of these cases that are filed against a policeman and take it to the federal level.
What about our elected officials? Why can't they do it?
They won't have...
Why can't they do it? We got Earl...
Because they are afraid of the union.
Why would anyone be afraid? They're law enforcement officers. They've got a job to do. You know, I mean, it just makes more sense if they're enforcing the laws that we are the ones that generate. Then we elect folks, if you will, to kind of oversee that piece.
It's fine as long as it doesn't apply to them. Law enforcement does not apply to them. Why do we have a chief of police right now who's getting paid on a pension because he lied and shot a guy when he got drunk? Why we got a chief of police who said he went to a class and he didn't go to a class, and whether he lied about it or whether the guy who signed off that he went to class lied about it, it's not relevant to me. They're both doing something wrong. Do you want a policeman that lies on an official document? Leading you, working for you? No, I don't.
Wow. Why not just go on and hand that responsibility to the police department? Why don't we just go on and elect the president of the union and make them mayor of the city?
I don't think the president of the police union has the political savvy to take care of that. And it would not be in his best interest. He'd be shooting himself in the foot.
Well, you know, the point
because he's, because the, if he is a police officer, he should be working as a police officer.
Right.
He should be a union president, one of the two. I've never felt that they should take two spots because he's taking a policeman's job and he's not doing a policeman's work. He should either be put on administrative leave until he's tired of being the union rep, or they should just hire him back without any prejudice when he's through being the union president. But you shouldn't have two jobs. You make too much money. You'd be a cop or be a union man, but you can't do both. That's my money, taxpayer money, you're sucking up when you're taking two jobs.
But a lot of these guys, you know, you figure the guys that are on the streets and whatever, they're pretty neat guys, don't you think?
I think that...
What's the deal?
I think that
not
most,
all of, them,
most
right?
of the guys on the street are wonderful cops.
Yeah, right.
You know, they're there for the right reasons. But it's always been a problem that the best cops don't make the best commanders, because the best cops aren't usually that good at taking tests. And people that are good at taking tests aren't necessarily good policemen. And it's been that way forever.
Wow. Well, you know...
That's
you know,
how you get people... up there that don't know what's going on.
Yeah. Well, you know, in all due respect, we're bringing this issue back up, folks, to the viewing point. And it just keeps going on and on and on and on. But imagine the money that's being spent
just keeping us in this foyer.
Yeah.
You got me?
Yeah.
Imagine the number of cops that could be on the street. When I think about the protesting aspect of it at City Hall, I mean, that could be solved easily as far as I'm concerned, because in all due respect, you got all those folks that are kind of like detached to just do that, when they could be doing the other task aspect of it.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is that you got the mayor's supposed to, you got the protesters aspect of it, and then you look at, well, let's talk about the solution. On Wednesday morning, a person can say what's on their mind, 3 minutes on the front of the deal. 3 minutes. You can barely sit down by the time for three minutes aspect of it. And then that's just a frustration aspect of it. And then the folks get up, they're upset as it is. And but let me go back a ways. To go down to City Hall and be there at 9 o'clock in the morning, to be there in the chair at 9:30, and only four or five people get recognized aspect of it.
Mm-hmm.
You imagine how much time that takes? You'd probably have to get about 2 or 3 hours ahead of time. You're right in the middle of traffic in the morning, right? You got me? It's a work day aspect of it. Then they get in there, and then they pretty well got to make the statements or whatever. And then there's no, communication is between two people, right? So when they get through making their comments, somebody should have said, well, no, it doesn't make sense, or yes, it does make sense, next. But they don't do that.
Yeah.
They don't give them the opportunity. So I think a solution to that problem, Don, would be why not appoint a protester ombudsman? And the job of that ombudsman would be, because when they go in there and say, well, I want to make that 3 minute aspect of it, they file a form, right? And in the Tribune, thank goodness for the Tribune, that's a first, by the way, the Tribune prints it on that Tuesday, in the Tuesday edition, okay? So now you pretty well know what the person is supposed to be talking about,
yeah.
But the ombudsman knows that too, and the mayor, and the city council. They would approach the person between that time period,
yeah.
Right? Because they get about 3 months, it's about 2 or 3 months by the time they get there, but they could solve that problem between the time that the person signed it and the time they're supposed to get on. Then,
I like the idea.
What do you like? You like that idea?
I like the idea.
See, it'd be a good deal, see? And then everybody's happy. And then they don't have to worry about having maybe a whole squad or a whole battalion of police force right there. Got me? It'd be the ombudsman. Go out there and see what's going on. And then what you do is that once the ombudsman sits down and talks to the person, then you identify the commissioner for the bureau to handle it. Says, okay, Solomon, that's your job for that one. It's a housing deal, or it's a neighborhood deal, that kind of a deal. And then that way, it's their responsibility to deal with that person.
Gee, we get 3 minutes a week to talk to the king.
Yeah, isn't that something?
I don't like the whole
thing. And then he can't do it all. He needs to understand that, and Ted needs to understand that. Maybe he's got other objectives and goals and whatever, but Ted, he's sitting in a very frustrated situation.
Oh, yeah.
Like you said, the tire cutting and going down to his house. I mean, he's sure he's got a family with him, but he doesn't understand. Being the mayor of the city of Portland is a 24/7 job.
Yeah.
You get a shooting up in northeast, southeast, or southwest Portland, you got to get up out of your car, in your bed, and get down to that deal, right?
Yep.
That's his job.
Yep.
Okay? And I fear for the guy, because now we got homeless, we got mental illness. We're not taking care of them. You know, the mental illness institution is on the streets. Remember when Damage was there?
I do, yeah.
Damage was there, and that's where a person could come. Now, they're all out on the streets. Sometimes they're getting shot and killed and whatever, because, you know, they got a hammer or something and they're attacking. And, you know, nowadays, they just shoot first. And a lot of these young folks that are policemen, as well, they got the education, but guess what? They don't have that common sense stuff on the street, so they shoot first. And like you said, they got their own court system and this, that, and the other. It's a tough job. It's a tough job to approach a person. In fact, why don't you spend a couple of minutes about shooting somebody? That's a tough job.
It's a tough job.
Now, my point is that, but when you were a cop, and we've done this once before, aspect of it, you didn't have a Glock with 50 rounds in it.
I still can't believe it.
Isn't that something?
Bruce, we went out the door with 12 rounds.
Isn't that something?
12 rounds, or 6 rounds in a gun and 6 in a belt loop. You know, that's all we had was 12 rounds. So.
And most of those were so worn out. I remember those days when I could see I'd see his belt and the aspect of it, and the bullets looked like they were so old.
Yeah,
and they were worn out.
They'd been in there a long time.
And the only thing he had was kind of a slapstick in the back of his pocket.
Mm-hmm.
If you have to Am I right?
Yeah, you're right. Yeah.
Very simple deal. And he walked up and pretty well knew what the who the people were because he knew his community. He knew the area that he where yeah. whether he was downtown, southeast, southwest, or whatever. Hey, John. Hey, get up there. Get your, wait. I know where you live. Hell, I'm gonna take you down there.
Yeah. Too much specialization is what has destroyed the police department. A lot of it is that nobody wants to be a policeman anymore. They want to be a gang guy, or they want to be a traffic cop, or they want to be an internal affair. Nobody wants to do police work anymore. You used to be able to hide in radio.
Yeah.
You know, the radio is now all civilian people.
Yes.
They used to be able to hide in jail. City of Portland doesn't have a jail anymore. It's a county.
Yeah.
So there's no places for these guys that never were, really didn't want to be a policeman to hide anymore.
Yeah. So
I don't know. It's just...
Oh, and a couple of minutes with Roberto. We got to do that because that's kind of... I mean, I hate to put it back on. Here we go. We got a place, Roberto, brand new building. Brand new building. We spent $55 million to build it to start with.
It's not paid for either, by the way. It's not paid for.
But $55 million, right?
Yeah.
And we're going to sell it for $10 million, right?
Yeah.
It's an outfit. Why can't the city of Portland again a solution? Why can't? Because the city of Portland's got the problem. I got 2 minutes, real quickly. Why can't the city of Portland buy the damn thing for $10 million, right? And then basically say, let's take the people off the streets.
No.
We got beautiful property over there. But anyway, that's another deal. I hope Ted understands where I'm coming from on that piece.
Take down the bars. Take down the barbed wire.
Yeah.
Take the bars off the doors.
It's
a school. It's a medical facility. It's a
well, make
dormitory.
Make it just a mental illness institution. Because all your homeless folks are pretty well classified that way.
Yeah.
And give them the service. Yeah. Bring in the National Guard to help out the situation. For health there or whatever.
Yeah.
But my point is that we need to use that facility. Why get rid of the building? Like I said, let the city would buy the deal and use it and get the folks out the street.
Maybe we should ask Wheeler that again since he was
well, that's what we're doing it now.
County commissioner.
Yeah, that's right. He was a county commissioner.
And he didn't
do
anything about it.
He didn't do a damn thing about it. No, he didn't.
Wipe it over there.
Yeah. And we're still right there we are. Yeah. And guess who has to pick up for the new tab for the new building?
Yeah, us.
Yep. Like this summer when we're going to be all overflowing with all kinds of folks, we have to jail them. So where do we go? Right? Now all of a sudden we need another bonding measure to pass that. Well, anyway, we've had quite a share here of some thoughts here. Please, by the way, talk with your friends, talk with your neighbors about this issue. Call up your mayor. You elected him. If you didn't elect him, he's still your mayor. I mean, he is the chief. He is the guy in charge aspect of it. And on this Eudaly deal, please, Ted, don't use it like that. Now, you're going to be basically assigning the bureaus, and that's the way it's going to be. And it's going to be interesting to see what you do with Eudaly. What do you do with this young lady? She went in there with a mission. She had a plan. She represented folks. Now she can't. She's not matured, but the rest of them are. They didn't want that bureau. They didn't want to fire black folks like that. Okay? Well, all right. We've had a good one. Don, it's a pleasure. Teresa, thanks very much for doing this piece with us. We'll see you next time, folks. Have a good one. Remember, you're in the Oregon Voters Digest. The buck stops here.